This is a proper comparison of two small, lightweight, attainable sports cars. Toyota has introduced the new GR86, and the most natural competitor to it is the Miata.
We are aware that the Miata is not news. But what's interesting is it continues to be an icon in the automotive market and kind of exists in a place mostly by itself, mostly because things are changing.
When the FRS was introduced back in 2013, I said that it was version 1.0 because it felt like software that companies just kick out onto the marketplace and they let customers figure it out, do things if you want it to, you know, get better. This is version 2.0.
There was a lot of internet chatter about that first gen 86, and Toyota definitely heard all of the things people said and all of the things that people thought.
If both Mazda and Toyota were driven purely by profit, there would be no reason for these cars to exist. Fun cars wouldn't exist. Fun cars that are refined and attainable.
Great cars, great roads, and all the reasons we love to drive.
TV, web, and podcast. This is Everyday Driver.
Over 30 years ago, when Mazda built the very first Miata, I don't think they realized it would become the benchmark that it has become. The Miata is so good at what it does, its name is an acronym. You've probably heard it before, M-I-A-T-A. Miata is always the answer.
Why do you buy a Miata? Well, you buy it because you want an affordable, fun car. You want something that you can chuck around that isn't unbelievably expensive, and you can actually feel like this is a really good dynamic car. Of course, you're looking at me and going, why is the top up? Well, I do want to show you this car with the top up so you can get a sense of the styling, but you're right. The key thing about a Miata is, of course, top down.
It's like a classic miniaturized Ferrari. Like a sexy, long-nosed front-engine Ferrari. Beautiful, clean surfaces with flying buttresses at the B pillars here and iconic details, headlights and taillights. That is the recipe.
The amazing thing about the current gen Miata is the fact that they've packed most of a $30,000 normal luxurious interior into a car that is 3/4 scale. The materials are nice. The build quality is excellent. Everything is very easy to use and ergonomic in here. It's all just slightly smaller than you expect.
It's just a tiny car, but look at the shapes. They're clean, they're simple, they're interesting, they still have character. This car is not brand new as far as the style. It came out in 2015.
I've got wonderfully heated seats. There are speakers in the headrests. Everything feels kind of premium in spite of the fact that this car isn't all that expensive. Now, $35,000 is a lot for a car that is mostly a toy.
I think this car will be in the future pantheon of Jaguar E-types.
Here it is, a car the automotive world has been fascinated about since it was first announced, and that is the second generation of Toyota's 86, now called the GR86 for Gazoo Racing. That's the same GR you see on the back of the Supra.
And when the president of the company gets behind a car and really falls in love with it, and the claim is that nobody is a bigger fan of the new 86 than Akio Toyota.
What's great about this GR86 is that Toyota didn't start over. There were so many things that were right with the first generation. They've just taken that first gen and revised it throughout.
Everything about this car says more beautiful surfaces, a little bit more muscular because there's more meat in those surfaces, and just because the headlights aren't that distinctive shape, that doesn't mean they aren't beautiful. A cleaner, classic design makes the car look beautiful and age more beautifully.
Notice these vents and strakes in the car. Unlike its sister car, the Supra, they're actual aero on this car. This doesn't just have weird creases and opening vents for the heck of it. This actually has brake cooling.
And when you sit inside, have you noticed that the more track-focused a car gets, the simpler the shapes are? Look how relatable these are, more so than the Miata RF.
They've refined all of the switches, all of the knobs. Everything in here actually feels more premium than it did.
And the instrument panel, have you noticed? It looks like a flat four. It's the boxer engine, the cylinder is horizontally opposed with the crank right in the middle. The seats are just as good as they were in the last car, but I think they've actually improved them from here.
Big guys have space in here. You have helmet room. You do actually have back seats. Now, they're not big.
I'm no longer feeling like I'm in a cheap, tinny car. I'm feeling like this is substantial. This is so well thought through. And the best part is the price. What Toyota has done to keep the price down and still deliver this.
Everyday Driver is brought to you by Covercraft. Use the code EVERYDAY22 for 10% off your order.
For me, I've never really loved Miatas. I've loved the concept of them. And there's two reasons. And the first is power. I've never felt like they could truly get out of their own way.
The big change with the ND2 of this car was a revised engine that added about 20 horsepower, but no torque at all. However, the big thing it brought was personality that the original engine in this fourth generation just did not have. This is freer revving and more interesting to work with, and it just makes this car even more endearing, which is hard because it starts pretty endearing.
It now makes 181 horsepower, 155 pound-feet of torque. That doesn't really sound like a lot, but this car, remember, is still under 2,500 pounds, even the RF. That little bit of naturally aspirated horsepower does wonders for this car. Finally, it's eager. Mazda has upgraded the red line too. It's now at 7,500. It revs very strongly, very easily.
Unfortunately, when they first released this model, they had some pretty serious transmission issues, and a lot of people were killing their transmissions not very far into the ownership process. Now, Mazda has a standard recall happening on it when the transmission goes bad. They are replacing them. Apparently, they've solved it by this ND2, but that was a serious black mark on this generation.
That just whines so well. Mazda has defined performance driving, sports car driving with this car.
The MX-5 is both agile and docile, and that's not something you find very much. A lot of times when a car has great reaction, it also can bite. This car has spectacular reactions, and it's just easygoing.
It really does it for me now. This is the car, the Miata, that I've finally fallen in love with. The power is there. Why hasn't it been here before? Now it is. Mazda has solved everything about the Miata with this generation.
The problem with the 86 when it was first released is it had an engine that was less than stellar. What's interesting though is it was one of the best modern sports cars with incredible dynamics right from the factory in spite of that marginal engine.
Well, good news, Toyota has eliminated the torque dip. They eliminated the engine that caused the torque dip.
That original four-cylinder was just kind of uninteresting to work with. This is a motor that actually seems like it's excited to be here.
She pulls now. That's exciting. Yeah, this revs more cleanly, revs faster.
Still a flat four, but this time it's a 2.4 liter, and that terrible torque curve that just went in nothingness, well, it's been improved and moved.
This even sounds good. I never liked how the other engine sounded, and this one sounds great. You don't have to thrash it all the way at the top end of the red line just to get the power, just to make it move. Thank you.
There's a lot of engine noise in the cabin. In the last one, there was a sound tube in the floor. In this one, it's a speaker. It's actually piped in, and I think that is one of the biggest strikes against this car. I cannot believe in a car that is so designed for driving purity, and that has been Toyota's focus. They decided to pipe in engine noise. I am hoping that there will be an easy-to-solve way to kill that, because I just don't want it.
Now, you can get your GR86 with an automatic transmission. It's got paddles, and it is really good. But when Toyota is so focused on making this a driver's car, this is the one you want. If we're all into saving the manuals, well, here's two companies that genuinely have.
Toyota also made changes to the gear shift. The shifting feel is different. They've improved the diagonal shift placements, and they've also improved your ability to get into second. It's just easy. This is not the car that you're gonna brag to anybody about how fast it is, but it has enough power to feel satisfying, and it didn't before.
Everyday Driver is brought to you by Griot's Garage. Use the code EDRIVER for 10% off your order.
Now, there's something about the handling on this car. It is a 15.5:1 ratio, which sounds rather slow. But keep in mind, the wheelbase on the Miata is really short. It's under 91 inches.
That really short wheelbase and the light weight makes this car feel like a go-kart. And I know that's a cliche, but that is the closest reference that the average person has to how this car feels behind the wheel.
It's very crisp, very precise. Look at that. Keep your eyes up the road, hang on to the corner. Wow. That's just excellent.
So playful and so easy. Just happy to do whatever. Chuck it in. Feel confident about it. Don't worry. It slides a little bit. You don't care. Everything's easy to catch and work with.
There's something missing right here through the turn. There's a bit of feel missing for me. There's no deadness on center, but halfway through the turn, where's that feel? Where is it? Did Miatas get too refined? Well, no, I think this is the best iteration of Miatas they have ever built.
You can find the edges on an actual normal human road, and you can play with them because it's not scary at all.
You can just feel the rotation of the car. This is, after all, still truly a front mid-engine car. It's so eager, it so wants to just move. The best part about this power is now it doesn't lag, it doesn't wait. There's no hesitation anywhere through the rev range because it's got enough power. It's just got enough.
On a tight road, the Miata definitely feels littler than this. You can really tell the difference. This is a foot longer with a foot longer wheelbase. That is a huge difference in wheelbase length, and you can definitely tell on this back road.
Yes, they can go fast. Yes, they can do track kinds of things, but they're almost better suited for a very tight, twisty road like this. Because you accelerate through the corner, yep, come up to the next, brake, downshift, and then sample the corner, savor the corner. Oh, that was delicious. Let's do it again.
This car isn't any less fun or any less capable. It feels every bit as fun and capable as the Miata does. It's just not as light and chuckable because, of course, it's both heavier and longer. This car wants to be driven hard, though.
This is channeling the transaxle era Porsches for me. You know, 944s are just beloved because of their balance through a turn. 50-50, perfect balance. This is channeling that. This is channeling every GT car you've ever driven that's excellent, and all the BMW sports cars that we love.
Because they've stiffened this body like 50%, it's amazing how flat and stable this feels, even far beyond the Miata. This has a surprising amount of information from the steering, from the chassis. It's not a fire hose, but at the same time, everything you need is here, and the car is so agile and communicative overall that you can always tell what's going on.
But the best part is we can finally throw away that journalist complaint, well, everybody's complaint about electric power steering, how it's not quite up to par as the old hydraulics. We can firmly, explicitly, and definitively throw that out because it is as good.
Like the Miata, this car can be your teacher. You can be a marginal driver, and you can go to autocross and track days, and you can learn to get better in a car like this. You're not going to overpower yourself. In spite of more power, it isn't an overwhelming thing to the chassis. It's just increased the balance of this car. The power now feels as good as everything else has always been.
There's just a fluid consistency with this car now. Shifting, steering, that the first gen didn't have. The GR86 is no longer the car that was, yeah, fun to get the tail out and kind of drifty and just lightweight, fun to drive. It's okay. This is a serious sports car now. That's great news for all of us.
I can jump back and forth in these two cars and find myself in love with either one of them. They're both spectacular to drive.
Two unique cars that are both under 3,000 pounds. They are the natural competitors. So which one do I want? Even though this has the power, I still don't know that I'd buy one.
The Miata's like that old friend you used to be close with, and they call you up and you think, do I want to go out with them again? Do I really want to relive those days? Is that going to be any fun? And then you do, and it's a blast. With the GR86, Toyota's done something pretty unique in that they've maintained all of the fun and lightweight enjoyment of driving that you can find in that Miata, but they've taken away the convertible, which is a bummer. In its place, you got a car you could buy as your only car.
The Miata has a genuine, solid competitor because of price, because of handling, because how good the dynamics are. We had the S2000 era, we lived through Z3s, but it seemed like all those fun cars kind of went away. The fun cars at an attainable price level. And then the 86 came along, and I thought, okay, this could be something. But I feel like it hasn't been until this second generation GR86 now that the Mazda Miata is actually challenged again. And this is the car that I want. Because you're saying, guys, you have to choose, right? At this price level, it truly is a shopping experience.
Yeah.
So which one is it? I'm going GR86, and I've never been on board with the 86.
Are you as stunned as I am? Because if you listen to the podcast, you know that Paul has never really been a big fan of the 86. But here's the thing, Toyota took it, and they actually looked at all the things that were good, and they left those alone, and they addressed the shortcomings of the first generation. And as a result, they have made a fantastic car. Both these cars are 4 stars. I would genuinely own either one, but then I have to think about who are these cars for and which car should they pick? And then I started thinking about what if it's your only car, because that's actually the only problem with the Miata.
That's good.
It can't be an only car unless you want to really accept those sacrifices. The 86 does all that and still is almost as lightweight and as chuckable as the Miata is. In fact, I think it's every bit as fun to drive as the Miata is, and it's more usable. That makes it, I think, the most usable sports car being made and sold right now, and that's huge.
When we disagree, we just let ourselves disagree. It's organic, and we have various reasons. But when we agree, you know that the new GR86 is good, right? This is the magic. A day like this, the top's down, a road like this. This is where Miatas shine. But funny enough, I find myself wanting to be in the GR86.
If I had one car as my only car, I couldn't get a Miata. I couldn't have this be my choice because it isn't big enough for me, frankly. And I want a little more versatility than this has. There's no question that if what you're shopping for is a fun car, a toy car, and you can do two seats, I think in that scenario, you probably should pick this over the GR86 because it's amazing it exists. It's so easygoing, and you just kind of want to own one and chuck it around and ring it out and just cackle your way down the road.
Power was what it needed. Stiffening the chassis and focusing on track performance has differentiated this car now completely. It is an entirely different car than the first generation. It is a worthy, delightful 2.0. It's the one I want.
Of course, it never feels quite as small and light as the Miata because it isn't, but it feels the next best thing in all of those metrics while still giving you, guess what? Usability.